wrong button. Hello and welcome from myself, Jamie at GeoSynths. You're doing very well on this Sunday evening. Episode 193, I think it is. And it's absolutely pinning it down. And I feel a little bit naff already because everyone has got lurgy at the moment. And I'm no exception. So it's great to see many of you in the chat room. Let's see who we've got, who's turned up. We've got Paul Artola. Hello to you. A Division, I Sing the Body Electric, Paul Holmes, Ian J. Cole. We've got Imperfect, Wagyu, James Glue, Wagyu and James Glue. We've got Cornish Waves Music, Lisa, Atto Z, Andy Brooks, and a whole host of other people. So, yeah, thank you very much for joining me on this Sunday. And I thought I would get on two very important people within our sort of music world who are very, I'm sure you'll know them as well. And recently did a seminar at Synthfest 2023 recently about FM synthesis. And I'm just going to play a little bit of it. And it will give it away just a touch. Here we are.
Shelley, and before we do anything else, can I please draw your attention to the screen? We know, okay, it's linear phase modulation.
Now you tell me.
Yes, it is the fantastic Robbie Puricelli and Manny Fernandez. How are you doing, guys?
Very well, sir. Thank you.
Very good. Very nice morning in SoCal today.
Yes, excellent stuff. Well, guys, thank you very much for joining me. I wanted to get you on to obviously follow up, really, from the seminar, because it went down really well in the room as well, as it has since. So you've had like a good 28,000 views, which is it's just ticked over, which is good for the seminars, which is, well, I should say it's great for the seminars, because sometimes, you know, some people can, because they're quite long, some people thought, oh, I'll just skip it for now. But that went really well. And I think it was balanced out. You had the kind of history, you had the technical aspects, but we also had the demonstrations of like some of this old systems. And many of us, like, you know, as you pointed out in the video, Rob, that it was like, many in the room were over 50, and we remember a time when just linking one box with another box with one cable was like, oh, you know. So, but of course, the demonstrations then with yourself, Manny, and the sounds, and the it kind of everyone gives FM a little bit of a sort of bad rap, really. And I think it's because we're always looking to the future a little bit rather than trying to look at the past. When in reality, you know, those sounds still stand up today. So anyway, guys, I just want to say thanks very much for that seminar. It went really well, and I know lots of people enjoyed it. So on to you, Robbie. So, you know, how did you kind of come up with the idea for the seminar and what you were going to do for it?
I can't remember what came for. I mean, Sound on Sound approached me and said, would you like to do a seminar again this year? And I said, yeah, not sure what I can do it about. And then it just kind of dawned on me that, you know, 2023 was the 40th anniversary of the launch of the DX7. And I thought, oh, well, there you go. There's something I can do. And then a couple of things happened. First of all, my good friend Simon Alexander popped over one day and he says, here, have a look at this. And he hands me this package of 5 1/4 inch floppy disks that contain, and it was in a plastic container from 1985. It was all a little bit squished and stuff. And it was the YCAMS demonstration kit that dealers and stores and demonstrators all had, or, you know, some of them had. And they would use it to demonstrate, you know, that YCAM. There it is. Yeah. So they would use that to demonstrate the YCAM system, which is the QX1, the TX816, the RX11 drum machine, and then, you know, a DX7 or a KX88. And I thought, oh, this is gold, because, you know, this stuff doesn't get, you know, I couldn't find anything about it on the internet. So I thought, well, here's a great thing. You know, we can demonstrate YCAMS, which was this kind of real, I hate to use the term because it's overused, but it was a groundbreaking moment where one company came up with a whole bunch of tools that allowed a single musician to make multi-track electronic digital music. And again, like you said, you had kind of had to be there to kind of appreciate that. So that was that was it. That was, I thought, yeah, I can do this. And then speaking to Manny, as I often do, Manny said, I'm going to come over to Synthfest because I've managed to time, he'll tell you all this, I'm sure, but he managed to time a particular event in his personal life to come over. And I said, would you want to join me on stage? Because like, you're an expert on this stuff and we can maybe tag team and we can look at the old and the new, because, you know, we've got the Modi X7 as well. So yeah, let's do that. And then, you know, we just, we corresponded and I sort of built my bit and Manny built his bit. And then we kind of put it all together and we didn't practice anything. It's not like even the night before. We
not
just
that you could tell. On,
no, yeah. So we just walked on stage and there it just happened. It was a stream of consciousness, but it seemed to be really well received and I'm just blown away by it. I just didn't imagine that at all.
Yeah, it was definitely there's definitely Lewis and Martin in their finest moments, right, Rob?
So, Manny, I mean, you know, that's a big kind of thing to do, really. I mean, of course, yeah, Rob's just said that you sort of tied it with something else, but to then sort of go and do this, decide to go on stage and show it, because, you know, maybe lots of people may not know the actual impact you've had with sound design with Yamaha throughout the whole years of a whole range of their different sort of synthesizers. So, you know, what was your kind of initial thought on how you would approach it?
Well, like Rob said, the point of it was to celebrate the 40th anniversary and to show the lineage of the TX to, you know, the Modi X and the Montage and, you know, the released 1 week after Montage M, to show basically, you know, FM's been here all the time and to break people that it's just electric piano one, you know. Yeah. Or the bass from Take On Me, you know, that kind of stuff. Because, you know, better or worse, DX7 saturated recorded music through the 80s, you know, for a lot of very, very good reasons. But what's interesting, and I had this conversation with some colleagues of mine, the working environment when you're recording in studios is completely different than like what you and I do, Jamie, in that at the end of the day, you've got to have tracks on tape. So you don't do new programming in the studios, you know, you layer what you have. And so programming gets driven by either new product launches or third party people, okay, in terms of seeing new stuff on it. So the FM sound got, quote, stale very fast because essentially they were using and relayering the same stuff for long, long periods of time. And like everything in music, goes in and out of fashion. And it went out of fashion very rapidly because there was nothing new in it. But it only was because that was the presentation. And my role with Yamaha, you know, I like to say I'm the lab rat they keep down in the basement where they just throw food under the door. And, you know, because I'm not actually in the field. Okay. I'm one of the very few consultants with all the companies I've worked with who's not a working musician, not a working recording musician, not a composer. I am just a exceedingly passionate hobbyist. And I chase rabbit holes that other guys don't have the time to do. And that's what I've done with them for, gosh, over 30 years, you know. And
so when you approached it, because you mentioned in your seminar, actually, you know, and just then that where it kind of fell out of fashion, the D50 had come out and it was the first of those little attack samples and all that type of stuff, which you then kind of mimicked those elements using the TX816 and things like the reverb tails and all that type of stuff, which is quite a technical feat to be able to do with sort of FM synthesis. So have you got a certain style that you would say or certain go-tos? Or with Yamaha, did they have like a certain, just make it sound like the D50, or were you just given full rein to do whatever you like?
So on Rob's podcast, he did, there's the thorough story. The short version is the whole genesis of was not from Yamaha. It was me doing a favor for a friend who owned a music store who wanted to sell more DX7s again because he really liked them and couldn't sell enough D50s that people are asking for. So I actually made a custom sound set for him. So when people said in, oh yeah, I like the DX, but gosh, this D50 sounds so really cool. What do you like? Well, I like this sound, Fantasia, Soundtrack, Digital Dancer. Oh, well, you know, the DX7 can do those guys too. And they go, what? And that's actually how it started. So when Yamaha heard that work, that's when they officially brought me in to work for them. And the joke I said at Synthfest is I was brought in to not make FM sound like YCAMs anymore.
Yeah.
And those techniques were things that I developed on my own originally in an 816. And I used the term harmonic component modeling, which is the fancy way to say, how do you do modular synthesis with FM operators? You know, each group of operators does a certain part of the sound. It might just be the attack. It might just be the body of the sustain. So the thing that gets overlooked in DX7 is it's a digital programmable algorithmic synthesizer. And that algorithm is because the arrangement of all those operators give you a bunch of, you know, options. And then when you multiply that across multiple engines, 8 in the TX816 or 2 in the DX72, you have a lot of things that are completely outside of the realm of a basic single DX7. So what I did in that sound bank was I accentuated what we call the stuff. Dave Bristow famously coined this phrase stuff, which is the attack, noisy little transients in the sounds. And FM is phenomenally good at it. You can get great stuff with just two operators or one unusual operator interaction. So recharacterizing that aspect of it. And then using oddball things like fixed frequency operators, both as carriers or modulators, complementary envelope times to make your reverb tails that have weird wobbles or pitch shifts in them that have longer time than the main sound with, you know, less bandwidth, blah, 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 blah. So, you know, you build the reverb part in it, you know, using parts against one another with slow LFOs or intra algorithm fixed frequencies to do a slow pitch drift amongst the part of the sound. You can make the chorus effects, things like that. And that's what all built into those. So it's just, you know, allocating your resources to do very specific things. So that's how it all started.
I think that's great because many of us, we're so used to subtractive synthesizers and we're either scooping from the top down or from the bottom up, where with FM, based upon their algorithms, you can get multiple frequencies separate, like bands of color, I suppose. That's one way to think about
correct.
It. And then using the multiple, parts like you have on the TX816 or the more newer montage-y type things, then you can layer those up and get sounds which you can't really get from analog. Analog has its place, don't get wrong. I wouldn't be doing this without
absolutely.
Analog synths. But but I think, my first ever synth that I bought back in 90 was a DX7 Mark II. And it was from I'd done 6 months of extra shifts in the casino. I used to work in casino. And I sold my record decks, doing all scratching and everything. And I got this DX7 Mark II, no manual. And of course, back then, no internet. And it was like, what is this? It sounded great, but where's the filtery bit? Because I had a bit of knowledge before, so I had it for 2 weeks and I took it back, and I ended up with a Roland D10, I think it is. So that sort of dates the time, but I didn't give it enough time, obviously, and I was just a young 19-year-old kid. And I think many of us, we use FM since it's come out again in software form or some hardware since, and we don't really give it the time that it needs, because we do have this preconception that it's maths. That's what it is. It's a bunch of maths. And while that's true, there is to it, it's not as immediate as, analog. You've got a big knob. Right. I sometimes say, some sense, all you need is just a bucket-sized knob in the middle for the cutoff, because that's all that people touch. Yeah. So what do you think people get wrong about FM? And I'll go to you first of all, Rob.
Well, as Manny said, and he says in the seminar, Dr. Chowning said it's an ear thing. And I think people approach it, or maybe they've heard, you know, these awful rumors of it being this impenetrable and it isn't the easiest thing to understand. It certainly in the, you know, the early stuff, it was very menu divey, but it's no more or less menu divey than lots of other things. It's muscle memory. You just need to know where to go. But if you program FM with your ears rather than trying to work out, you know, looking at Bessel function tables and all of this kind of stuff, that's going to bog you down. Whereas if you just like say, well, as Manny says, very in the seminar, start off with just a pair of operators and see what happens when you change the modulator and see what happens to the carrier and once you understand what that does to a sound, then you can write, okay, well, if I increase the ratio by this much, I get this outcome. And then you start building things, and again, if you start building things in pairs, and then you can start adding in another operator here or the feedback loop there, and eventually you get to understand. And I'm really not the greatest FM programmer in the world at all, but you know, you get to understand what happens, and you remember what that sounds like. And that's this whole thing about just doing it by ear. And I think a lot of people are just put off, and it's just, you know, it's easy to dismiss, what for many, many years was the biggest selling synthesizer of all time.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah, it was used, you know, in a very preset heavy way. But there are lots of presets out there, some amazing presets. You know, Manny's created a whole ton of them. And there's no harm in using those, but it just got to use them. And so I think it's just become fashionable to have a dig at it. But I think if people sat down, especially with, you know, nowadays you've got software versions such as OPS7 from Plogue, which I think is the best software emulation of a DX7. Everything's just nice and big and clear. There's no menu diving. All the controls are there for you to see, and you can very easily start learning what happens when you do that with this. And then it's just like, you don't approach an analog synthesizer. Again, I'm quoting Manny's seminar back here, when you first approached an analog synthesizer, did you know that particular waveform made a particular type of sound, that you didn't know that a sawtooth was responsible for certain types of sounds? You just did it by ear. That's all you got to do. It's just a different method, that's all.
Yeah, brilliant. Exactly. Brilliant. Manny, would you add to that in some way?
Well, sometimes I've described the difference as languages. Is any language inherently hard? It's just, what's the first one you learned? Okay, and then is the second one you learned totally from a different direction? Like, you're an English speaker, you're going to go speak Chinese, or you're an English speaker, you're going to try maybe German, and so I think that's, part of the reason everybody was familiar and well-versed in a language, and this was Sanskrit. Okay, yeah. But if you were born writing and reading Sanskrit, it wouldn't flummox you at all. A lot of people that don't have the bias FM synths with their first synths, I didn't quote know any better.
Yeah,
that's what they had to learn.
It's a fair point. And like Robbie said earlier, DX7 was everywhere. I mean, talking like here, we had this phenomenon of working men's clubs where you could go for cheap beer and there'd be a stage and there'd be a turn on doing a song and everything. And you'd see DX7s everywhere. You know, they might have electric piano underneath and then a DX7 on top, and that, all those sounds, it changed that world from, cheesy organs, and even though FM can do organs, but from cheesy organs and a drummer, and then all we had these nice electric piano sounds and the odd synth sound, which was weird to see back at that time, some old guy playing all these weird lead sounds with
sounds.
50s music. But it was, it certainly, they were everywhere, and it's a sound that, yes, has kind of got this stigma to it, but I mean, your demonstrations in the seminar showed a totally different light, really. And of course, then going on to what's still going on in the modern world with, just the recent Yamaha Montage M. But Robbie was talking earlier about the YCAM system, and I can remember my days of getting my Casio RZ1 drum machine and getting a MIDI output and going into a keyboard, and it was playing the sounds off the pads. And it was like, what's this magic? What's this voodoo going on? So we'll play a little bit more of the video to do with the Wycam system. So check this. I'll probably get done for copyright, but hey. That's that typical sound, isn't it? It's that DX bass sound with the electric piano. That's where you're, that's 80s. And of course, you know, Rob's demonstrating there that this Wycam system, you know, produced the soundtrack to that TV show, and nothing else was used. It was just the whole system. And it did allow musicians then to just do it on their own. And while there was an element of that in the analog world, obviously with like Vince Clark when he left Depeche and all that sort of stuff, that was like lots of gear, you know, it was monophonic synths, and so you had to have tons of them, whereas this whole DX sort of Wycam system, you had it all in one and you could do the whole kind of production, which freed up a lot of people, and we started to hear that sound more and more in, and it filtered down into TV shows a lot and kids programs and all that kind of thing. And you know, it made a massive sort of difference. But of course, modern times, things have changed even more. We've got the latest Montage M, and you, Manny, have done a ton of presets for it. And I'll play a few over here on your channel. And we can go with Wave Art Pad, and we'll have a check of some of these sounds.
Whale Runner is a real good one.
Which one am I looking at? Whale Runner.
Okay. Whale. Check this. Whale Runner.
Check this one here. Sounds amazing. Amazing. Lots of things going on, lots of different colours and textures and stuff, especially in that last sound. So, Rob, Manny, when you come up with a sound or your idea and you're sitting down, what your kind of process? Do you think of a sound already and you're trying to emulate what's in your head, or is it a case of, you know, I haven't done a pad for the last few sounds, so I'll just do a pad? What's your kind of process?
You know, that is an excellent question. I am given very, very little direction these days. And part of that's because one of the things I do when I get a new synth to program is I want to find where the architecture breaks or does something really interesting. So that's obviously very non-directed. So a lot of the first weeks when I have something, truth be told, I do a brass sound, I do a string sound, I do a keyboard sound, I do a choir sound, and I do a like pad sound, just because I have to learn the architecture, right? Okay. But now I'm going to go in and I'm going to find out whatever modulation options it gave me, whatever range of parameters they gave me, how are those all going to interact and do something? So I am looking for accidents, for lack of a better word, or just quirks of the operating system. So now I'm looking for those little sonic pieces that then I can go put back into some of those particular categories. So the reason why I'm particularly fond of Whale Runner is it uses the ANX engine for the obvious CS80 polyphonic AT nod, but the second layer is all FMX doing some very complex real-time harmonic sweeps and timbre shifts that are, again, also controllable by the poly aftertouch. And it doesn't utilize a quirk per se, but Yamaha indulged me for adding some very specific modulations in their controller options for doing certain things that only apply to FMX. And then I was able to leverage those things in that particular patch. So that's how some things come around like that. But, you know, I'm always looking for like a spectrum. Ace, can answer this question. The thing that's really weird about sound design, and I know you find this the same thing that happens, when you really want to get to a really technical patch, I want a wow patch, okay? You're talking complex modulations, you know, in terms of envelopes, real-time control, layers and textures that shift. You've automatically put yourself in the land of pads, right? Because a comp sound, the note play lasts half a second. What can you do in half a second, right? You can't. Yeah. So when I don't want to say I tend to do a lot of pads, but I like to do things that are spectral soundscapes that have a lot of real-time control so that, you know, you can just do synthesis. You know, I'm not the emulative guy, okay? I'm not the guy you have reconstruct your sampled piano, you know, because that's a digital recording. You had some filters on it, and that's always going to be a sampled piano. So, that's kind of how I approach it.
No, that's really good, especially the way you say how you try to find happy accidents, and it's like you've got a thought in your mind. It's going to be a pad, so you're using the CS, and that's you're making a typical, in quotes. But you're making ingredients, aren't you? You're putting all these different ingredients, and they've all got their space in the spectrum, and then, sonically and stereo. So to see how they all kind of come together. And I know from myself, when, not necessarily FM, but sometimes you'll do something, you think, oh, what's that? It sort of grabs your ear. It's like, right. Whoa. Yeah. And it is. It's like, I'm going to do more of that. But then you've got to get the balance of, you don't want that type of tone or thing to happen all the way through. It's got to be a little surprise here and there, everywhere, isn't it? But that's exactly. A really good way of describing it, for sure. Now, Rob, obviously, you know, this seminar, it isn't the first one you've ever done. You've did a fair bit with the Fairlight before. You had Steve Levine on. Now, your seminars are very informative, but they're really entertaining as well. I mean, what do you sort of come up with in terms of the process? Is there a kind of set of goals that you want to deliver to the audience, or is it a case of like we do in our sound world, look for sort of happy accidents and things like that? Is that a similar approach to you?
No, I'm because for my day job, I've been in the training industry for 20 odd years, and so my day job has always been teaching people how to do stuff and teaching people, you know, the history of stuff and how it affects what they're doing, and it's mostly been technology based. So I kind of have a grounding in that, and so when I build a course to deliver to someone, there's always an end goal, and that's where you start. You start at the end. What do I want these people to walk out of this room with that they didn't have before? And that's where you start, and then everything else you do hopefully builds towards that. So in the case of the Fairlight, you know, I wanted to make sure that the story of how the Fairlight came into being and the impact that it had, both in the music that was made with it and the way it was listened to, that story as accurately as possible was told to the people. And I still watch that sometimes and think, oh, I wish I'd done this or done that. And I'm always doing that. I mean, I looked at a quick snip of the one we did last month, just, you know, earlier today, just to kind of remind myself what we were doing, because it was all a bit of a blur. And I think, oh yeah, I forgot to say this or do that and didn't put this in. So yeah, but that's where I'm going. I know where I want to go because I know what I want my audience to walk away with. And that's how I start building them. And yeah, you know, whether it's a seminar at Synthfest or whether it's you know, guest lecturing at Keele University or whoever, you know, I've done a number of these. I'll speak with the organizer or the, you know, the person that's commissioned me and say, yeah, what is it you want them to leave with? That's how, you know, that's where we're going. So and then there is this essence of I want people to know the truth about something. And you know, it, especially in our world, there's so many different stories. You know, I've sat down with, and I'm not going to mention names, but I've sat down with the actual inventors of particular instruments, and if there was two of them, one would have one version of the story and the other would be fairly close but not the same. And they'd look at each other at certain points during the conversation, you know, I don't remember that. And so even at that, there's still, you know, there's this. So what I like to do is try and speak to as many people as possible and get a good approximation of the truth based on all of the stories. You know, we can kind of piece things together. So that's what I like to try and do. So, you know, with the FM stuff and YCAMs, there was a lot, there's not a huge amount of stuff available online. So it was trying to talk to some people who are using the stuff. So, you know, I made contact with Dave Bristow and spoke to him a little bit about it. And, you know, speaking to Manny as well, who was on the ground around that time. And so you get, you know, the facts and you put them together and then you run them past people and get fact checked. And it's just making sure everything is good. But then also try to make it entertaining because hopefully people will come because it's a very specific thing. You hope that, you know, the bulk of the people are there because they want to be there. They're not, you know, it's not like some work thing where you're forced to go and sit in front of a trainer for 3 or 4 hours learning about health and safety. This is, you know, they want to be there. And that's what blew me away, really, because, you know, I am sometimes, you know, sort of known as the FM protagonist. You know, I'm the, you know, every time somebody mentions an FM thing, oh yeah, I bet Robbie will like that. Well, yeah, but you know, so it was. It's still amazing to me that there are people that, you know, they slate FM as much as they, you know, they do, because I think it's fashionable. I think it's kind of cool to have a thing to dig at. But I think deep down, and Andrew Brooks will back me up on this, deep down, you know, they actually like it and they are interested in it. And so when you get a room that's not only all the seats were full, but there were, you know, there's people stood at the back. It was, you know, literally standing room only. And then it took Manny, it took an hour to get from the auditorium back to the main hall because we just kept getting stopped by people.
Yeah.
Oh, that was amazing. It was amazing.
It was amazing.
Yeah. Was, and that was just so humbling. Yeah. And, and then we went.
Sorry, I was going to say, it was a very strange experience because I do NAMM shows fairly regularly, but, you know, I go as a participant and things like that. But this was a little bit different because, you know, I'm there, quote, you know, because, you know, people wanted to see what we were doing. Mm-hmm. And the reason why it was weird is because it was just very shocking to me that people had, A, that interest, okay, to find out the details of something that is, for lack of a better word, you know, it is a specialized taste, you know?
Yeah, I think it's, I mean, a lot of people, like I said earlier on, sort of dismissed it because it's in the past, but I think of recent years with, like, for instance, Core coming out with, you know, their Op 6, and then in software, you know, that you've mentioned, and even things like, the Roland System 8, they dropped like an FM update to there, so you could use the two oscillators as different types of levels of FM. And even like Nord have put that in their synthesizers as well. Cut down versions of it, but still it's there. It's a kind of taste. And so it's always been there, I think, under the surface. But I think the thing is, you know, we've all been looking to the new, like I say. But then again, when you think about it, what has come out new in terms of the analog world is really just built upon what was coming out in the past. You know,
and I think there's also a thing with popularity, and it's, you know, it's like the U2 effect or the Coldplay effect. You know, who were for a number of years the best rock band on the planet, bar none. And they were making hit album after hit album. And then it was, they were just everywhere. And then they reached this kind of precipice where it's just like, you could only go that high. Now everybody's going to start hating you. And it's just going to, and the same with Coldplay. Coldplay made two or three really brilliant albums. And then they got so popular that it's just very easy to turn around and say, oh, Coldplay. It's actually, it's cooler to not like Coldplay than it is to like Coldplay. And it's the same with FM. It was so popular. The DX7 was over every record. And, you know, you only have to listen. I mean, if you ever get a chance to watch the Don Lewis movie, because Don did a bunch of sounds for the factory presets, and they talked to one of the guys from the NAMM Museum, and he said it's easier to say what the DX7 wasn't used on than what it was, because it was just everywhere. And people lapped it up, but then all of a sudden it just kind of, you know, it got to that point where it just, the only way is down now, and so it just became very easy to dismiss it. And then of course other things come along, that, you know, shiny new things, and your attention's distracted. But
to dovetail on that, what's very interesting is that when its sonic popularity started declining is when the technical advances in it were actually going on, and a lot of people missed it. In that, by the time, you know, Yamaha came out with the SY series, which was to be its, you know, Me Too version and try to surpass the M1, a lot of people, I don't want to say didn't care, because the SYs were fairly successful, but they got stuck in the, you know, sampler end, the rumbler end of the instrument, not realizing that the AFM engine that's in the SY is arguably still today one of the most versatile engines that they ever produced, because it's multiple non-sine waveforms. You can have operators as zero frequency wave shapers. There's digital filtering. There's loopable envelopes. There's three assignable feedback loops. And most importantly, there's individual operator phase offsets. And when you start playing in that space, you find and discover that FM is so ridiculously versatile, okay, not just in its own sonic space, but emulative of many, many, many others. It can be a wave station if you want it to. It's a fantastic versatile analog. It does classic analog behaviors like pulse width modulation and heart sync. And these are things that most people don't know because they had moved on when technology got more mature. Obviously we know the quote is sometimes called the pinnacle of it, although I disagree. It's very neat because it's got a fantastic trick that it does, which is the format synthesis and the FS1R. FM covers massive sonic spaces that any other individual synthesis honestly can't touch. I mean, you have to know the language, but it's all in there.
It's good. I like that, that you have to know the language. And you know, the DX was a massive disruptor to the industry. I mean, you know, once that kind of came out, people were flogging their Jupiter 8s for pennies and all that sort of stuff. Do you think we'll ever see anything like that again, that kind of disruption?
I'd love so, but I don't know. It's been so long, because you had analog synths that were disrupted by FM. Then FM was disrupted by sampling and sample-based stuff. And then that was displaced in maybe a lesser fashion by physical modeling, and then obviously analog modeling. And there's been
physical
nothing...
modeling was supposed to be the next big displacement.
Yeah, and it didn't.
You know,
it didn't. No, but the thing is, and peppered through that, you've got things like Wavetable that have, you know, stuff that's, you know, obviously, you know, with Hydrosynths and things, you know, that's still I mean, you've got two great examples behind Manny there, Hydrosynth and Third Wave. You know, Wavetable's making a bit of a comeback. Physical modeling's making a bit of a comeback. You know, you've got some wonderful physical modeling instruments. And I hope that one day that gets realized, as, you know, as we hoped it would have been back in, you know, at the turn of the century. But I'd love to think that there was something that would come along that's completely new, and I'm sure it will, but I just think it's going to be a long time, because where do we go from here, you know?
Yeah, no, it's interesting that. I mean, you know, you were saying sort of, Manny, that, you know, FM went sort of on the low and hidden. No one was really looking at it. But then that coincided with the technical advances, so then it could do extra things. Maybe that is going to be the way of the future, that there's going to be more technical advances in, obviously, the computer side of stuff, and then processing, and it's just retaking what we've already got. They hit a home run first of all, didn't they, in a sense, with analog, and then you know, FM, and then the samples are, you know, they're the big guns that fired, and whereas now it's just, you know, a small amount. But interesting stuff. I'll play a little bit more of you, Manny, actually. And this was you demonstrating with the Amodi X7 Plus. And I'm not sure what sound it's queued up, but I will queue up as well and play this amazing acoustic piano you made.
Massive real-time controllations that you didn't have back in the day. So Rob has in his rack in here a FS1R, which is not hooked. That's one single patch. That's not a blend. That's not a layer. That's one set of 8 operators being real-time controlled for ratio, index, envelope times, and all that sort of stuff. It's what they call a smart morph patch. And I turn the motion sequence off. You can play this in real time. That's pretty cool, at least I think it is.
Amazing. That sounded great in the room as well. You know, there was lots of stereo and all that sort of stuff going on. I remember looking around at some of the people there, and there were, you know, they weren't like looking in the phones or anything like that. They were, you know, eyes and mouth open a little bit. That, hold on, is this FM? It's not the doorbell ringing that I'm kind of, you know, thinking of, or that clunk, clunk sort of sound. It's swooshing. It can do things that... that many people who aren't familiar with FM, maybe because they're of a younger age, it's like, well, we can do this.
Yeah, well, I'm going to make a real quick point here. It's like, yeah, it's like, what's the next thing? What's the next big thing you're looking for? It's like, we have so many tools that do so much. I mean, it's really less, why do we want something new all the time? Okay, right in front of me is my SY99. It has not moved in this position in the 20 years I've been in this house. Okay, and I turn it on and I program it at least 4 hours a week. I've done that for 20 years. I did it for 10 years before that. I know it inside and out, intimately, forward, backwards, upside down. And I would not trade it for anything new.
No.
Ever.
No,
you know?
You do.
I have
you
all this other gear. And it's all great. Yeah. You got to learn your instrument.
No, it's true. You know? It is. It's, you know, when there is so much gear coming out, you buy it. It depends on your process as well. If your goal is to make music quick, then, you know, sometimes the manual goes
different
out the window.
Yeah,
it's like, I want to get something down quick. But if you want to, you know, do sounds, make your own sounds as well as your own music, or do sound design, it's a different sort of approach to it. And some synths you'll just have a natural affinity to, because at the end of the day, lots, especially in the analog world, since they're all the same, they just have, it's like driving a car. We all know how to drive a car. It's just the buttons are in a different place, aren't they, with each
exactly.
new one you buy. So it's learning all those quirks where the buttons are, and sometimes you have to go around the house to get what you want. You know, it's like playing Twister sometimes, when you have to hold that button down when you do that, and you stick and use your nose to to get some modulation. Actually, it's a bit like that with this thing.
Great. That's a great synth. I love mine.
Oh, it is a lovely synth. It is lovely, definitely. And but it's great how things have sort of carried on. But maybe those disruption times have gone. And like you say, there's so many tools out there that you can use. But sometimes just mastering that one in front of you, and that'll teach you, you know, a great amount of things. You know, so you can know that when you look at that knob or that slider, you know what it's going to do before you touch it and how it's going to affect everything else. It's a knock-on effect rather than big bucket filter.
You know, looking at some of the comments coming up in the chat, I would say that if I was going to pick the next disruptive thing, it's not going to be a sonic engine. It's going to be something related to interface. Either from a controller input standpoint or the way that computer-assisted and or macro-oriented program interfaces come along that allow people to do, you know, complex things in a directed accidental basis without having to learn, you know, or be intimidated by, like, what the DX7 did way back. So, you know, there's probably going to be some disruptions in interface more before there's another disruption in sonic creation.
Yeah, it's an interesting that there hasn't been an easy mode a lot of the time.
Atari
have done a little bit of that, and then you can advance and go in a bit more. As long as you've got enough controls to mess with, the controls you need to dramatically make a difference in the sound. But physically, we haven't really sort of had that. Though there's been some attempts. In fact, there's something that came up about, if I can find it. The old Reface DX, the new version by D-Tronics, a new editor, which fits along the back. You know, you can get it for, I think it's €269 if you've got that. And in fact, that Reface DX was probably the one that kicked it off again in hardware form.
Yes.
The sort of whole FM. And then, you know, before we just, it was just software and, you know, maybe manufacturers didn't, and Yamaha were the right people to do it. Always puzzled me, though, that there wasn't a Yamaha FM synthesizer until Korg came about that was knobs and lots of knobs, lots of sliders, things we're into. And maybe that's right, it's the interface that's going to be the next thing that will sort of change in times. But anyway, there has been a question. Can you ask them, now that they've both had the Essence FM for a while, what's your opinion of its strengths, stroke, weaknesses? And I'll go with you, Robbie, first of all.
Where do I start? I mean, it's an amazing synth. I like it especially because it has a large touch screen, and this plays right into what we've just been talking about interfaces. The fact that you can now see on a large screen the detail of what you're doing, and you can just, you know, move things around, organize things, flip, you know, there's a few buttons on there, but you know, you just flip from, you know, tab to tab, and it's all visual, and you can draw in your envelopes and you can move your operators around, and it's all just so nicely laid out. Sonically, I mean, it's pristine, it sounds amazing, it's super clean and has all of that, you know, classic FM stuff, but then lots of very surprising stuff. And you know, Manny has done some great patches on there that, you know, you just think, really, this is coming out of that. It's very clever, and it's so powerful because I mean, it's 300 note polyphony, and you can take, you know, it's got that kind of, you know, architecture where you build a voice and then you can build a patch that contains multiple voices, and you can build a performance that contains multiple patches, and then you can assign that to, you know, every MIDI channel. You can have all sorts of things going on, and there's a new firmware that's coming out hopefully very soon. It's going to have a sequencer built in there as well, and it's all in this very nice built, very sturdy unit. It's probably, I would say, one of the best hardware FM synths, but unfortunately it just sits underneath everything and not many people really have experienced it, which I think is a crying shame, but it's a really, I love it. I think it's great.
Excellent. Manny, what about yourself?
I totally concur. And one of the things I like about it is that it's basically the most direct descendant of AFM in the SY series, whereas FMX is a sideline of it. And it does what an SY99, if it was a TX816, would be. Okay. Mm-hmm. Because like you say, you have your six op patch that you put performances and you layer it up 300 notes of polyphony. So you can do these the integrative part programming like I did on the montage, like I did on the 816, a whole nother magnitude because of the polyphony. Because it's got almost double the polyphony. Actually, it does have double the polyphony of the montage. And so, yeah, no, I love it. And the fact you can throw your own user waveforms into it is also really cool. Mm-hmm. And it's got some filtering as well, and it's got a pretty good mod matrix. And it is fantastic. And like Robbie said, it just sort of flies under the radar because I think people aren't looking for FM per se unless you already know about it. And but once you get on that touch screen, like Robbie said, you can see they have animations of the signal flow when you play notes, just to show you like what's feeding where. Yeah, it's actually really kind of fun.
Yeah, that's good. Better than the DX just LED, double line and going across. Well, but
So before we move on, let's just point out something about that DX interface because, to Robbie's point, once you learn the muscle memory, programming DX7 is like playing a keyboard. You just remember the buttons. But more importantly, you got to remember, and this has been very important for people like you and me, Jamie, and many others, which is the DX7 spawned the third-party patch.
Yes. No, yes, very true. And because everything sort of coincided as well. I mean, we had MIDI and, system exclusive. Though, I wish someone would bloody change system exclusive. Why we still have it to this day, bulk dumping from synths. It drives me nuts. But there it is. It hasn't sort of changed. But yeah, you're right. Third-party patches all kind of came out from that. And because previously, I mean, it was deep. I remember. In fact, I was moving stuff around, and I got my old JX3P out, and I put it on the desk. And you you have to record. It's like old computer sound, like dial-up sounds to get it backwards and forwards on tape. So I sat down and I made a bank of sounds on it, and that was like. Then record it to a WAV file, so people have to play a WAV file from the phone, which is like bizarre. So that SysX was a lot better then, but of course that came out 83, I think it was, and they even though it had MIDI, it didn't have any sort of implementation of system exclusive. But it's funny how it's some things have sort of changed, and I really like how FM synthesis has gone into or elements of it. Other synthesizers. So I mentioned, there was the Nord Wave 2, and even some of the AM1X, not AM1X, the other one that they did, which I've got. And they had you could choose it as a source for your oscillators is FM, and it usually comes in two various types. You'll have basic, and you can go all the basic waves, and then modulate it by an envelope and everything. You get those classic. Typical sort of FM sounds, but then the complex ones are different level, and then you can mix them together. And then the added thing, which of course DX didn't have, was filtering. So you could filter those sounds, and the System 8 did it, and it kind of ties in a little bit with something that's recently been announced. Roland have put ACB back in the Phantom, or into the Phantom EX, whereas before it was either the System 8 or... the cloud, and which is good. So it shows that they haven't forgotten ACB technology, rather the other type, the cut down version. But yeah, I used to have a System 8, and the System 8 engine itself, that's when they dropped in FM basically simple oscillators, well, algorithms in there. You couldn't really choose any algorithms. They were pre-created, but then tied in with filtering, and I did 64, I think it was, for it, so I'll play one or two. So there, that's the kind of using sort of them as the algorithms for the sound source. But of course, yeah, there's a fair bit of cheating going on because of the filtering going on. But I did make one sound and I can't find it at the moment. I call it Old Man. If I can find it. Can't find it, but what it sounded like an old man who'd been on cigars and whiskey all night, and he was just coughing the next morning. It was the most bizarre sound I ever made. But anyway, it's cool that that's all in there now. Coming back, maybe they'll bring in the System 8 engine into the Phantom. Though they need to fix their aftertouch on that thing first. You have to sit on it for it to work properly. But no, I mean, you know, what's sort of you know, the kind of future for FM, do you think? Will it, you know, be more hardware instruments, or is it going to be more, like you said, the sort of interface? Where can it go, do you think, Rob?
I would personally, I mean, this is just a little personal thing, that I, when Yamaha brought the FS1R out, it included, as Manny mentioned, formant shaping and sequencing. And at the time, Dr. Chowning said, this is, I'm paraphrasing it, but he said, yeah, this is the next obvious step in the progress of this form of synthesis, because it just, it can, within the constraints of the platform and the paradigm, and it works, and it produces some amazing stuff, and it really does. And the FS1R, I mean, it's what they're selling for £2,000-£3,000 a module now. And I'm sure Manny's going to tell us about what he's got on sitting on the shelf at some point. But what disappointed me about the Modi X, also the FMX engine, was that they basically took the 8-operator FM engine from the FS1R, give or take, and put that into, you know, these synths, and they left the formant shaping behind, which is what really made the FS1R such a special, special instrument. I mean, I've used it on various things, and the stuff it can do is incredible that no other FM synthesizer can do. And so I would love, you know, I was kind of secretly hoping when the Montage M came out that, as well as adding the brilliant ANX engine, that they would have maybe updated the FMX engine to include that. And maybe that's down the line, who knows? I have no insight into that sort of thing. So I'd like to see that. Mm. But you're right, maybe as far as FM is concerned, if somebody, I mean, you know, Korg did a really good job with the Op 6 in terms of its interface and making it hands-on and much easier to get results quickly in a, you know, in a more traditional sense. So maybe, you know, maybe we see some more stuff like that. You know, the FMX engine is so deep and powerful that people still probably, we still haven't fully utilized that just yet. So yeah, that's, I'd like to see formant shaping coming back in.
Mm, excellent. Manny, obviously you've worked on the Montage M and the AM1X engine that's in there as well. How have you found the sort of using those two engines together? Have they worked very well?
No, very well, because their intrinsic behavior is in a different sonic space. And so they layer very well because they do things the others won't. You know, in the AN1, the ANX, you've got your classic analog textures, so you have very dense harmonic structures. You have a very, you know, rich detuning or, you know, spatial quality to it. And then, you know, FM inherently has those very precise timbres, and so they can mix very well. And of course, you can take the FMX and you can actually do stuff with it to go play in that space. And there are some neat little tweaks with the way that the hard sync and the analog FM works in ANX that you can actually take some unexpected turns out of that as well. So you can actually get them to merge in the middle and then cross through. So yeah, I think they work really, really well together. So it's not just a basic virtual analog in ANX. It's pretty sophisticated and tons of real-time control, which is the key. So when you talk about like the direction of FM, FM as a pure method, I have less interest in, because to be fair, how can you say you've reached the end? You're not going to get much different by adding more operators or more waveforms or more features per se. Okay. The behaviors, at least for me, I'm pretty comfortable about what I know it can do in its own. So whether you have FMX, AFM, you have an OP6 or MOD7 in the Kronos. Where FM gets really much more interesting for the future is where it interacts with other synthesis types. Okay, so FM with filters. That's a completely different area of possibilities than you can get inherently with FM alone. So if you play with an OP6 or use, you know, MOD7, you can put a low pass filter in your signal chain. And when you do FM of a carrier with a modulator that has a high resonance sweep through it, you get a different behavior than just a regular index behavior. Okay. You can do that kind of thing in the SY because you've got the dual engines. You can take your sawtooth wave, make your big TB303 cracky, distorted filter sweep, use that to FM your operators on the FM side. And then you have things E15, which some of you may know I've recently done some work with, which I love. And that leverages the interface of FM with physical modeling using a very capable FM system as the driver to a physical modeling system. And it creates behaviors that are stuff you don't hear in other platforms since we've had the VP1, to be honest. And so that's what I find more interesting, is how you hybridize these things together. You know, so you mix FM with sophisticated filtering, physical modeling, and that I think is much more cool than just saying, how am I going to extend it further?
Excellent stuff. Excellent. Well, I will try and find this piano that you made. It was Rhapsody Blue, I think it was, which it blew me away when I was sitting in there, I must admit. So hopefully it's a playable point.
But stuff. That's synthesis. That's not.
Yeah. I mean, you know, in the room, and I said to you, you could hear the resonance, the string resonance, which, you know, it has been the more recent things in terms of sampling and in having that as an additional. And it sounded, you wouldn't know in a recording. If you didn't, you know, you saw that, it sounded like a sample. Yeah. It was a sample. And that's what it sounded. But it was, you did this approach of essentially layering different harmonics to create the different mechanical parts or component parts of a sort of piano. Maybe you can carry on and go into detail about that.
Right. Yeah. So again, this is something that actually stuck in with the TX-816, where you use 8 modules to make one sound, not layering or detuning or that kind of thing. And so we started very early on trying to do acoustic emulations by using a lot of operators for stuff and having certain parts each module do certain parts of the sound. And so this came about because I just decided I wanted, and I personally extended that and went through DX7.2 versions of that, SY99 versions of it. And then when the montage came out and I was messing around with some stuff, I said, you know, I want to revisit this. So I called Nate Cheddar over at Yamaha. I said, I want to do something really stupid. Or just, I don't know if exactly. I think I said, I want to do something that's absolutely not necessary, but ridiculously interesting. He says, what's that? I said, I want to do a 100% synthesized FM piano patch. I know nobody needs one. Okay. But I think it would be an interesting demonstration of the state of the art, because it isn't electronic. It isn't electric piano five anymore. Mm. You know, we're so far beyond that. And he said, sounds interesting. So that's what we did. And so we did a five-part video series that accompanies an article series on YamahaSynth.com. And it shows how I built it from the mechanical action, the sound of hammer strikes, the noise components, the harmonic differences between the low register, the mid register, and the high register, specifically talking about how you have to generate, you know, a feel to the keyboard relative to the envelopes. Because the number one programming tip I'll tell anybody who's into FM, stop using your fastest envelope times. If they go to 99, use 84. Okay, don't use just one stage, use two stages, because the feel of it will change dramatically. And all of a sudden you go, wow, why does one sound play so much better than the other? And it has to do with the sort of the kinetic connection to your keyboard. And most FM implementations are so ridiculously fast to what we're used to from an acoustic basis and even an analog basis. Mm. So part of the harshness in FM has to do with, because the envelope times are a whole order of magnitude out of whack from what your ear is expecting. But anyway, so but the article explains all the tricks that we used. Throughout it, there's a ton of examples of whole completely different contexts of how pianos are used. And on my SoundCloud, I invite people to please listen to some of the classical and jazz pieces that are on there, because I did a bank of 16 pianos that are all in different contexts. So it goes from Hey Bulldog from the Beatles to some felt piano things that are good for playing in the, you know, smoky bar, you know, down at the, you know, behind all the drunk sailors kind of deal. And they're all
local pub.
Yeah, exactly. And so they all highlight different areas of what a piano sound actually is, because there's not just one piano sound, you know, the EQ, the mic position, the compression, you know, they're all over the map. So, and I can control its structure in real time.
Yeah.
And that's the other thing that's cool about it. So it's, we did that, and, I have to say, thankfully, everyone who's ever heard the work kind of jaw drops. There are certain things that are still not nailed correctly, you know, but I'd like to say, if you're coming at it from a critical eye, I already know the 10% that's still not right. But you know,
you can't tell. 90% that is. That's really looking at tiny little bits, really. You know, no, that's great. I mean, so we've been talking about FM and we've talked about the seminar, and of course there's all links in the description if people want to find the seminar, plus I posted it, and also links to both the guys. But you know, let's park FM and its whole history. Besides that, what synthesizer has probably been made the most impact on you? And I'll go with you, Rob.
Whatever, or in recent?
Or it ever. Could be both.
Well, I think that's a tough one, that is. I think Prophecy was one, the one that still to this day blows me away with what it can do. And that's one that I own, and it's one of those, you know, you will have to prize it from my cold, dead hands. It will. I mean, I don't sell anything ever, but I will never sell the Prophecy. And I think it kind of stems from the fact that I, like a lot of people, probably laughed back in 1995 when Korg were advertising a 37-key Sonic synth for £1,300 when I could get, you know, I mean, I'd got a Roland Sound Canvas, obviously completely not comparable, but it was able to do 64, you know, part multi-timbrality or 64 note polyphony and 32 part multi-timbrality, and this thing just did one sound at a time, and I'm like, but then I played one and it was just like, oh, but yeah, that's an amazing sound, or amazing set of sounds, and it really blew me away. And that's, you know, that's my other thing that I'd love to get into more of, but there's just not enough gear or money. You know, Manny's been involved in the restoration of a VP1, which, you know, I've never played one, never seen one, never touched one, but it's still, whenever I see one played, it just blows my mind. Mm-hmm. I mean, the Hydra synth is a fantastic synth. I've mm-hmm. finally got one to play with, and it really is, it's that great combination of hands-on control, ease of use, and expression, which again was the thing with the Prophecy. It was all about the expression you could get out of that thing. And the Polybrute is a fantastic synth as well. I think that's one of the best analog synths, certainly modern day analog synths, that we've had. So, and there's some great software stuff as well. You know, it's so difficult to nail it down. To, you know, what's been the best, but yeah, there's some cracking stuff out there. And the Montage M is calling my name. It's calling my name, and I will have to submit soon.
Yeah,
because it is a magnificent thing.
I was invited to Music Matter to do their sort of, you know, before it was revealed. It was a good video. And I only had 10 minutes before we started filming the video, but just playing it in the room, it just sounded so expressive. Much was kind of going on. So, yeah, I definitely, it's not the cheapest of things. So. And it would be the 88 I'd go for, and you know, that's the strange decision not to put it in poly 80 in the, at least probably the 7. But hey, there it is. That's what it is. But Manny, old and new, which besides FM, what synths are for you?
Well, I'd have to the Arp Odyssey, because the very first synthesizer I ever put my hands on, and that obviously started me getting interested in all this fun stuff that we do. DX7 goes without saying, because it, you know, put me you know, where I am, I guess. Related things, I have a lot of preferences of things that I think people need to be aware of. They don't get a lot of love. Kurzweils 1000 and the series, they are incredibly powerful. I was fortunate to be on the dev team for the 2000. And they have continued to bring it forward and modernize it. And I don't know why it doesn't get a lot of love, but it is a fantastic synthesizer. The modern, K2700 and the PC4s, the Hydra synth as a modern synth, basically you could argue that it is the, you know, first of the new Renaissance. 'Cause you know, it came out right before COVID. Mm-hmm. If somebody needs one synth that does so many things well, that's the one. In a weird way, it has some naysayers, like the DX7 does, because quote, oh well, it's blah 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 blah. It's like, you learn how to program it. It's as smooth as a virtual analog as you want. It's as digital as you want, and the modulations, real time control, you can't beat. I mean, they hit a total home run on it. My special sweet spot synthesizer will always be the VL1.
All right. Okay.
And as soon as I'm done with the show, I am going to unpack my standalone knobby programmer for it from Robert Scurry that just arrived the other day. And because it is the epitome of what this is all about for me, which is electronic musical instrument, an expressive instrument that happens to be electronic. And the VL series, and even more so from the VP, sorry, Robbie, is the most alive thing you will ever play and program. It is also probably the most frustrating thing you will ever program. But it's worth it when it pays off, because what it does to nuance of input is, it's real. Mm. You know, it truly is. And when I say real, I mean real in terms of changes to your input. One of the things that we lock onto is timbral accuracy if you're doing imitative sounds, and we lose the fact that there's a ton of timbres that aren't imitative that have absolutely wonderful evolution and dynamicism in a slightly different timbre space that kind of gets discounted. And, you know, I think the thing that's happened because sampling got cheap was certain aspects of the pure uniqueness of what you can do with electronic instruments has kind of maybe gotten lost in the noise. And that's why I will always have a sweet spot for the VL1, because the thing's alive. You know, the fact that it will not sound the same playing the same patch is the testament to me that, you know, physical modeling, you know, was the did not get what it was due as a synthesis.
Excellent, excellent stuff. Well, guys, it's come to the end of the show, and if there's like any tip you think you, an important tip that you would give somebody regarding, you know, not necessarily FM, but anything to do with the sort of our synthy world, what would it be? I'll go with you, Rob.
I think what Manny said, I hope he wasn't going to say this, I've stolen his thunder, learn your instrument. Because you can, it's so easy to fall into the trap of, you know, you buy a new synth, you think, oh, that's wonderful. Then you hear something else and you think, well, I need that synth to make those sounds. Well, try and make them on the thing that you've got already. I mean, there are some things that are obviously impossible to do on other instruments. But do you know what? The thing that I've learned over, I don't know, decades of playing with these things is that, actually, if you're clever enough and you know your instrument, you can get pretty much any sound out of it if you if you learn how to use it. And so, yeah, that's what I would say. Learn your instrument.
There it is, folks. There it is. Manny?
So, yes, you did steal my thunder, but I'm going to expand on
sorry.
That's all right. That's totally fine. And I would say let your frustration be your inspiration. If you have something that just isn't working for you, don't bail on it. Dig in and truly figure out how to make it work for you. Okay. I mean, part of the, I am known as the guy in the programming team. Don't say this machine doesn't do something, because you know, tomorrow I'm going to show up with it, because that's just how I roll. And so use your frustration as inspiration, because that'll give you the surprises. That'll give you something unique. That'll give you something that hopefully specifies, you know, what makes your approach to sound and sound design unique.
Yeah. You mean so, not just get oscillator one and sawtooth, oscillator two, sawtooth, detuned, filter. Go a little bit further than that.
Exactly.
Yeah. No,
exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And if it's not working, just pound your head against the wall. Go dive into it. Find a way to make it work. Find a way to do it. Because it's a good chance it's in there. And you just don't want to take the easy way out and say, this thing sucks. I'm going to get a summit.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. Excellent, excellent. Well, guys, thanks very much for joining me. Before we go, I mean, what you got going on at the moment? Anything new to talk about, Robbie?
So Pro Synth Network every Friday, some interesting things coming up on that. I'm doing podcasts for Sound on Sound. I've got a very interesting one being recorded soon that I can't say too much about. But that's going to be very exciting for me, personally. Let's see. Already thinking about next year's seminar, which has been commissioned. Don't quite know what, maybe I've got some ideas. Planning for Super Booth and all that kind of stuff. And I started my own business. So Fail Muso Limited is now a thing. That's mostly just to stay on the right side of the tax man. But there are plans for next year that, you know, might see me getting a separate studio space and moving the gear in there and making the gear pay for itself, which would be a nice thing.
Yeah, so,
busy.
Excellent, excellent. And yourself, Manny?
I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing. All I can sort of say is leave it at that. I personally want to put and expand about some more FM programming details on my YouTube videos, because I've sort of dropped the ball on advanced FM techniques on that. I have a couple of upcoming things I cannot speak about. But really, at the end of the day, you got to make music with it, right? And I want to take a special shout out to Grace, Inky, and Brooksy, because the reason why I'm wearing this shirt is that they took forever to convince me to actually start making music with all the crap I have in the studio. So I started doing that, and I want to keep contributing to my weekly hardware jams to show that my family don't think I don't do anything with all this stuff.
Brilliant. Yes. Yeah. No, we were saying earlier on, actually, you know, the way that I sort of work, it is like I work on one synth, spend a month on it, then it goes on the shelf and I don't see it for at least a year. You know, it's just the way it is. But
you know, I got to give you mad props, Jamie, because you have a successful role and business in third party sound design. And I did that years ago and I bailed on it because it just, I just can't deal with it anymore. And the fact you do so well with it and are so respected in it, you know, I want to give you mad props because it's hard to do these days. You know, when I did this back in the late 80s and 90s, it was a completely different business. And, you know, I'm not just, tell to the chatties, I'm not just buttering up the host. Truly, you know, I am very impressed with what you do.
Thank you very much. That's really kind of you. Kind of you, definitely. Well, guys, it's been a pleasure having you on and chatting about FM synthesis. So make sure everybody in the chat room, you go and check out the seminar. And I'm going to leave you, actually, with one of your jams. I think your latest one. Is that a good one to play us out? Reflections of Index?
Noise. No, actually, that's a good one. It's a Noisevember jam, yeah. But it's a good one.
Okay, we'll just check this out. Have a bit of a play using the SY99 montage and some Eurorack stuff. So.
Forward at about 30 seconds.